Good morning, everyone.
Great call and response in this place. We are going to have a special Halloween chapel this morning. Okay, it is the season, it's that time of year, and I'm sure there's some excitement brewing. I'm sure there's lots of costumes that have been worked on over the last sort of 48 hours, 24 hours, and maybe some of you who are going to do a bit of a last minute costume hunt or production tonight, getting ready and geared up for tomorrow. Halloween was a bit of a deprived childhood in some ways, and not in many others, but certainly one of the things that I lacked was a good trick-or-treating session. I think I might have done one or two before, but really it was something that I think, based off the sort of dentistry in the UK, they didn't really want you having too much sugar in the diet. I mean, obviously here in North America, the whole dental system is geared around Halloween and Christmas and sugary delights and things like that. So it's wonderful to see, and it's great to see adults getting so involved as well. It was certainly from the culture I grew up in, very much it was for children. And once you sort of were 13 or 14, you've grown up and you've grown out of Halloween. Not here. Okay, we're all in. Everyone's in, and it's great to see. So, without further ado, we'll start our Halloween chapel, and I'd like to hand over to Miss Hanson, who is going to introduce our first performance.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Yes, I'm going to introduce our first Halloween performance piece, but before I do that, I was just thinking about, I'm a fan of scary movies, but some people really get creeped out and they don't like to be afraid of things and be frightened. So I thought maybe I should offer something a bit reassuring. I was thinking about old movies that are set in creepy old houses with antique furniture and that's scary, but really, those things back then, they weren't old for those people. That was their normal. So I brought in this special antique telephone. Some of you may recognize it. And I was going to show it to Mr. Monroe because he's quite into antiques. And just to show that you shouldn't be frightened of old objects. And even though in the shop when I bought it, the guy did say a weird thing. Whatever you do, if it rings, don't answer it. And I thought that was strange because obviously it's unplugged, the number's not in use, it's not going to ring. Right? But anyway, it's really cool. If you'd like to see it, Mr. Monroe, I'd be happy to show you my antique telephone. It's got the numbers on because that's how we used to do it back in the old days. We used to dial it as I said, nothing to be afraid of with antiques. Moving on to our band performance, the senior concert band, grade 8 to 12, have been working for the last couple of months on a piece called Danse Macabre. And yeah, that is French, Mr. Hubboy. I accidentally played Danse Macabre. And you could say the dance of death. It's a pretty cheery piece. And it's based on a legend about every year at Halloween when the spirits or the skeletons come out. David's nodding, he knows this piece maybe. Come out of the grave and death plays his violin, as death does, and they dance around the grave. So that's the first piece that we're going to play. It was written originally, the music was written in 1874, even before our time, right? By Camille Saint-Saëns, French composer again, let's talk about. What else do we need to know? No, I think that's it really. Very proud of the band and I hope you enjoy their performance.
Thank you.
such a treat. And thank you to all the band members for coming together and just demonstrating a lot of synergy and collaboration. Having never played in a band of that scale, I think it's probably one of those things that if you haven't done it, you can't really understand how difficult it is to try to coordinate all those parts and pieces. So well done for your effort and your diligence to nail that. And thank you to Jason Chung as well for his videoing, videography and filming. Let's just give the band another round of applause. Chris. We have, I know you shouldn't really spring quizzes on people, but we do have a Halloween quiz organized for this morning. But it should be a bit of fun. It's just to test that knowledge out there today. And also to start getting a few of that, you know, just get the metabolisms kick-started with a bit of sugar. So we have Maria and Miu are going to be circulating, looking to see who's getting their hands up first for some of the answers. And we do have some candy, okay, for distribution during the quiz. To those who are getting involved and those who, particularly those who managed to get the right answer. Put together a little bit at the last minute, and as I tentatively said, well, it'd be great to have some student leadership here, and you know, sorry I haven't really given anyone enough heads up. Tegan Kropp immediately, I'll run it. So it's not a problem. Of course you will. So Tegan's going to come up. I'd like to invite her up to run the Halloween quiz. Let's hear it for Tegan.
Okay, so as Mr. Monroe said, Maria and Miu, if you'd like to stand, they have buckets of candy, and they're going to, so I'm going to ask a question, and whoever puts up the hand, they're going to say, oh, it was this person, and you will answer. If you don't get it right, you're still going to get candy, because participation, yes. If you get it right or just start participating, one piece of candy per person, please. And if you already guessed and got candy, you please don't guess again. Unless absolutely nobody put up their hand, but you probably won't get candy, I'm sorry. Maybe we'll be nice. Okay, so I'm going to say the question. If no one gets it right in a couple of times, I'll give you four choices. See if we can get it right. Okay, so number one, which vegetable was originally used to make jack-o'-lanterns? Yes.
Turnips.
Yes, it is turnips. Okay, number two. Which animals are most commonly associated with witches? What hand did you see first? Because I saw Jackson first out the corner of my eye. So, Jackson.
Bats.
No, bats. But you get candy.
What was the question?
What animal is most commonly associated with witches? Okay, I saw Yichen next.
Black cats.
Black cat. It is black cats. Okay, I'm about to butcher this word, but what is samhenophobia a fear of? Yes.
Dying in quicksand.
Pardon?
Dying in quicksand.
No. But you get candy. Okay. Mei Ling?
Salmon?
No. Yeah?
Yes, the fear of Halloween?
Yes, it is the fear of Halloween. Halloween is the second highest profitable holiday in the year. Which is the highest? Oh, I saw that hand first. Yes,
Christmas?
It is Christmas. Okay, now which country is associated with starting Halloween? Oh, Paul?
America?
No. Yes?
United Kingdom?
No. Yeah? Isaac? No. Okay, yes?
Ireland?
It is Ireland! Did everyone guess? Okay. candy do most kids prefer on Halloween? Let's all you, Gracie.
Candy corn.
No.
No.
Okay. I saw you next. Bennett.
Chocolate.
Chocolate? It is chocolate.
Yeah.
What was the original name for Halloween? Jesse? All Hallows
Eve.
Yeah? All Hallows Eve. Okay. Now we got a little math in here. I can't do math. If your over the top measurement of the pumpkin is 12 inches, how much would your pumpkin weigh? We can take wild guesses because I didn't know this either. Amanda. No! Yes.
2 pounds, 13 ounces.
No. Okay, I'll read it again. You don't have a lot to work off of here. So if your over the top measurement of the pumpkin is 12 inches, how much would your pumpkin weigh?
Yeah.
No, I'm looking at you, my minion. Looking at you. No. I.
12.
David?
It's 1 week, so it's about 2.5 kilograms.
I don't know kilograms, I'm sorry. But you can get to it. Okay, one more hand, and then I will tell you the answer. Jenna. No, okay, your options are six, yes?
Sorry, you have a four.
Yes, I'm gonna give you options now. 6 pounds, 8 pounds, 10 pounds, 12 pounds.
17.
No.
6 pounds.
No.
12.
No.
Ten.
No.
Who haven't I asked? Back there. I'm sorry, I don't know. No. Yichen. No.
Oh my God.
Pardon? It is 8 pounds. Okay. That was hard. Okay. Has everyone gotten candy? Because that was rapid fire. Okay, good. Okay. Dressing up has been part of Halloween celebrations over the centuries, but what was its original purpose? Yes. Yeah, to ward off the spirits of the dead, so yes, scare away. Now our last question. Which poet wrote the poem Halloween to popularize the term we recognize instead of All Hallows Eve? Yes?
William Shakespeare.
No. Miss Newsbomb, do you know? No, that's sad. Okay, I'll give you options if absolutely no one has any ideas.
Alright.
Okay. Your options are Robert Burns, William Blake, John Clare, or John Milton? Yes? No. Yes. Yep. Pardon? Oh, the no. Okay, I'll read them again. Robert Burns, William Blake, John Clare, or John Milton? Yeah? Yes, it is. Now, I would love to read it, but it's over 20 stanzas and I don't have the time for that. So thank you for participating in our quiz.
Thanks very much, Tegan. Just like to invite Ms. Hansen again up to introduce the concert choir performance of Double Trouble.
Okay, second piece. Wasn't the first piece loud enough for the people at the back, because I was sitting right by the speakers and I was going, turn it down, but maybe you were thinking, could do it. So shall we do the next one a tiny bit louder and I'll just do that? Not because it's not good, just the volume. Okay, so our second piece is the Senior Concert Choir, and They worked on a song called Double Trouble. And if you are a fan of the Harry Potter book series and movie shows, then this song was performed by the Hogwarts Frog Choir in the movie The Prisoner of Azkaban. But instead of the Hogwarts Choir, and Hogwarts is the boarding school where they learn about witchcraft and wizardry. We had that here anyway. We have the Margwarts Choir. It's pretty close. And they are also holding cool animals, but not frogs. And Double Trouble, the lyrics came from Shakespeare, but it's a play where I think you can't mention the name, so I won't say it, right? And it's all about witches and cauldrons and spells. So pretty tricky words, but hopefully you enjoy it and you can understand what they're singing about. Okay. Well done, Concert Choir.
That was excellent. I know some of you looked a bit shy and perhaps maybe not used to seeing yourself on the screen, but thought, love the costumes, great props, and wonderful sound. So congratulations and thank you. A couple of pieces ahead of tomorrow, just with regards to Halloween and a few things that are happening. We have the Student Council to thank, particularly the Grade 8s and the Student Council have really been a driving force behind this. They really want to try and bring a bit of fun, a bit of Halloween spirit into the day. So sent a message out around candygrams, and again, I know it's for many reasons it might be difficult to organise bags for people and to get these sort of candygram bags together. So that's the idea and the anticipation within the FA time as well, as to exchange a bit of that, but also just know that I'll sort of surreptitiously be supplying a bit to all the FAs as well, just to make sure that everyone can get off to a good start on our sort of Halloween day here at QNS. But please, if you can, get a few things, bring them along to your FA tomorrow. Haunted house. So that's going to be set up over the course of today and this afternoon by some willing volunteers, and it's going to take place in Founders Hall. And I know tomorrow morning after FA we have that tutorial time and an opportunity to catch up and see your teachers for any academic needs. You still should be able to do that. We're just going to provide a couple of windows for the different learning groups to have access to the haunted house, to come through and to hopefully have a bit of a scare just to kick the day off. Just to help wake up a bit, I think. But in Founders Hall, the 8s and 9s, you'll have a window of opportunity between 8:30 and 8:45. So we'll just I'll be there to help supervise and get a couple of other people to help. But just going through in sort of groups of fives and sixes, just explaining what that'll look like. We still have to be mindful and obviously adhere to the COVID protocols while we're in there. So we'll just have to set things up slightly differently. So head there and we'll let you know what it's going to look like. 8s and 9s, 8:30 to 8:45. 10s and 12s, 8:50 to 9:15. And I'll make sure that those timings are in the announcements as well tomorrow morning for that FA block. We are going to do a costume parade. And tomorrow we'll mark it out using some cones. But I think we'll use the field. And the 8s and 9s will come through first between 11:45 and 11:55. From the sort of residence area between the residence and Founders Hall in a spaced out line, come past the front of Glide Hall, around the field, okay, so that we can have a few spectators in the middle and some judges, just getting a chance to see all the effort and the costumes that people have gone to and the costumes that they're coming in. And then the 10s and 12s will be 11:55 to 12:05. And I believe there's five categories of judging, so I'm not sure if I'll be one of those judges or not. I think we might need someone with a real keen costume eye to come forward. If you would like to be a judge and you either know you're not wearing a costume and you'd like to judge, perhaps come and send me an email or get in touch with me. Then we'll announce some winners at lunch. So good luck with the costumes tomorrow, and I hope that that those bits and pieces that the student council put together are well received, and we can get into the spirit of the day. Switching tack slightly, Movember. I just wanted to say a couple of things about Movember. Why are we doing it? Well, we're doing Movember to try and raise awareness and funds for men's health issues. It started off really being geared around prostate cancer and testicular cancer, but now it's moved through to mental health issues as well, and things like suicide prevention. How are we going to do that? We are. Those of us who have a bit of growth on the face are going to try to. This is my least favorite month and the least favorite facial hair growing region. But we're going to try and grow mustaches, and in order to try and spark some conversation about these sorts of issues and just health and wellness in general. And how is that going to spark conversation? Well, when you go up to someone and say, you know, you've got a spider crawling out of your nose, that will then spark a conversation. Actually, this is not an arachnid. This is my attempt at growing my Movember, because you know, there is a certain amount, particularly for this sort of concept of masculinity, of not being vulnerable and not being able to talk and not wanting to go and see the doctor and just feeling you know, indestructible and like you can't talk about these sorts of things. And so we're trying to sort of wear away some of that the stigma associated with it, so that we can open up more and more conversations. We can start that education at this stage, then hopefully that'll continue as you move up and grow up through life. I'm going to start a school account, so I'll send that out. Those of you who are going to want to be part of that and part of the fundraising team, if you could sign up, please. The Movember Foundation is geared around supporting medical projects that aim to try to improve and address physical and mental health. You need to clean shave on the 1st of November, and then you're going to shave every day thereafter, missing the tash region. Okay, so you can't sort of grow everything out and then try and come up with something supremely stylish at the end. you need to wear and own the moustache. Mo sisters, this is another concept. So we can have Mo sisters who are there to support with the growing of the Mo's, providing some encouragement, helping perhaps market a Mo Rose Tash. So if you've got a friend who's trying to attempt to grow something, just helping them with the fundraising and that kind of thing. Why is this all geared around one gender? Well, in May, we've got it's Women's Health Month. And I understand those that gender is not a construct that's binary, but in May, we're gonna have a look at that Women's Health Month piece and create something meaningful for that period. And again, so we can hopefully get a whole school involvement. So that's also coming, even if it feels that the emphasis is on a particular area of the school. We'd like as much support as possible. And then in May, we're gonna have that opportunity to do something a little different. There we go. And on that note, I think it's gonna be break time. But we're going to head out to a final tune, a bit of a ghoulish tune to finish with. And I'm going to invite the prefects with the bins to head out with the candy. And on the way out, if you would like to grab something for the road, as it were, then you're very welcome to. Okay, you can sit, watch the first bit of this if you like, and then perhaps, Sydney, you could start inviting people to head out if they like. Okay, thanks everyone for a great morning.